Welcome to Community Crossfire, another point of view. I'm your host, Dorman Norman Oliver. Ladies and gentlemen, you've been watching JV. I've had my sister host the show. She's been like freshman of JV on varsity. She's in here, I let her do a little. So look, I got my main man, Pastor, the main man, Gino Jennings. So this is like, now this, that's pretty cool. We got like a little audience. So this is like the trilogy, right? Like the Thriller in Manila, right? Because we did the first one, second one, that's the third one, right?
Yes, sir.
So, look, before I get into that, I'll be saying, you'd be like, man, can you hold your hands? Did you box or something?
Oh, yes. You can't live in the hood without holding your hands.
Well, did you take up boxing?
No, I mean, boxing just come natural.
Oh, yeah.
Because all of my brothers was very good with their hands.
Okay.
So, I boxed some, did mixed martial arts some.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yes, I did. In fact, I trained as mixed martial arts for about 10 years.
Wow.
You know, when I was younger.
So, like, that tells me why when people come on stage, you say, get him out of here, and all, you ain't ready, you ain't worried about him coming back at you.
Oh, no, I'm not worried about that. I mean, we're not about violence in the church, but you come in the church, you know how to conduct yourself.
But, you said one time somebody was attacking your wife. You're like, don't make me come down here.
Oh, they actually did try. In fact, they actually did attack my
wife. Wow.
My youngest daughter was the baby at the time, and she was sitting on my daughter's lap, and she took off down the church aisle and took a swing at my wife. My wife went down to protect the daughter, and my daughter fell off of her lap. So she got several blows on my wife, and by that time they went and got the young lady and escorted her out. But if she would have had a knife or something in the hand, oh, she would have gotten my wife very well.
So has it gotten to the point, right, where you have to have security with people even coming to your church because you become high profile like that?
Security was suggested by the brothers in the church.
I remember that.
Because of that.
Uh-huh.
So since then, and it's sad that church have gotten to this point.
Right, right.
But yeah, we have the organized security team everywhere we go.
So you had a training like, I saw Malcolm X movie. It was almost like that. These guys are trained.
Yes, they are trained. In fact, they had to meet with the Philadelphia police captain.
Wow.
So they can know what they can do without being sued. And what they can't do. So we have legal right to actually arrest you and hold you on premises until the police come and get a hold of you.
Why do you think it's gotten to that point though? Because again, I don't want to, you know, I mean, I'm pretty good with following stuff and you probably didn't know that, right?
Yeah.
I'm storming, right? But I mean, I thought that was kind of deep.
It is sad that things have melted down to this low. Where church have to have security. You used to can come to church, come and go as you please. But they're coming, they're killing. They want to rob openly.
Mm. Mm.
So in church, all type of people come in. So it's kind of looked at as a youth determined terrorism. You have soft places where people go kill, like malls and stuff like that. Well, church is a soft target where they come in with guns, they come in with knives, and they will come in churches like that, but they won't come in other religious institutions as a mosque, for instance.
Right.
You go in a mosque like that, they're going to carry you out.
Yeah, they're going to carry you out.
So churches really have to step up their game as far as discipline. Making a very disciplined and safe environment for everyone who comes there.
But do you think it's also your notoriety? I mean, it's not like...
Yeah, it is because of our notoriety, because of jealousy, because of hate.
Exactly.
And to my sad regret, that just come with the package.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let's rank this thing up a little bit, right? As you know, I've been getting a lot for the last year and a half. You got me in a lot of trouble.
Wonderful.
Good trouble. I love it. So let's dive right into this, right? And I think, and you know it's funny, I just ask the questions.
Yes.
Right? I just ask the questions, right?
Right.
So the big controversy now is the P. Diddy and
T.D. Jakes.
T.D. Jakes. Yeah. The last time I talked to you, you called the man T.D. Fake.
I call him T.D. Snake. Snake. That's what I call
You call him T.D. Snake?
Yes, I do.
Why you call the man that?
If you know the thing about the scriptures, the Bible said about the serpent, the snake is most subtle than any beast of the field. And when you try to weave in some type of false teaching and try to make it justify you being subtle in your objective. So T.D. Jakes says that homosexuality and church can coexist. He don't see nothing wrong with it. He says he's evolving.
Right.
Now there is no man of God in the history of the Bible that would have evolved to same-sex marriages.
Okay.
None.
Not in the church?
Not in the church.
Okay.
Not in the scriptures. Not for real.
Okay.
Not a real man.
Okay.
If he's not in the church.
Why did you get upset, right, when Tyler Perry put his hands on him, right? I mean, couldn't a man had, I mean, maybe he did feel
something.
It
isn't that I got upset.
But couldn't he had feel something?
No. I believe in judging everything from a scriptural perspective, especially when it comes to church.
You thought it was just $1 million?
It's just $1 million.
So could $1 million just moved him?
$1 million will move most people. The scripture says this, the love of money is the root of all evil.
Right.
And this have become such a turnoff to people who have no involvement in church until church has become the biggest racketeer in the world. Mm-hmm. So when Tyler Perry, think of it, if you were a bishop,
right,
and I was a reputable cross dresser,
right,
you mean to tell me you were stooped so low that you will ignore me being a cross dressing man and allow me to lay my hands on you?
But isn't that
being some spirit?
But isn't that just his character?
No, the Bible says you can't get sweet and bitter water from the same fountain. So you're either going to do it God's way or you're not going to get credit.
So he can't be an actor? What are you, an actor?
If you're acting, you're pretending. If right. you're pretending, you're faking. So when it comes down to a man,
right.
who will get some type of suit on to make you look like you have breasts like a woman, stockings and right. lipstick and earrings and you're cursing and got a wig on. No real God-fearing man going to be dressed to look like a woman. Why is it that our men
right.
In Hollywood,
mm-hmm.
mostly black men,
right.
Hollywood pimps them out for them to look like women? And you look at the different stars, whether it's Tyler Perry, whether it's other different celebrities, how is it that we can stoop so low and sell our dignity and then put on a dress like a woman and then say Black Lives Matter? Black lives matter to who and to what? There's a certain level of respect.
Right.
There's a certain level of standard. Money should not manipulate us to the degree where we sell our soul and degrade ourselves at such a low degree until we can become a whore for Hollywood.
Gotcha.
And this is exactly the way many of these movie stars has become, nothing but a Hollywood prostitute.
Do you have a problem with pastors preaching and talking about prosperity?
Yes.
Why is that? I mean, some people would say, we want to get out of that situation, right? Poor, not having. So if somebody, but you understand where I'm going, right?
I understand where you're going.
So what's the problem with preaching prosperity?
First and foremost, one should ask, who's the one that prospered from the message? It's never the people. It's always the preacher.
That's deep.
They buy his cars. They pay his rent. They buy his houses. They buy his planes. They buy his yacht. The people don't prosper. The preachers put the people on a guilt trip and they make it
just like psychology.
That's all it is. It's religious psychology, religious propaganda. And they put the people on such a guilt trip that make them believe if you don't give an X amount of money, you won't be blessed of God or God won't bless you. I don't want to serve of God that if I don't have no money, he can't do nothing for me. I don't believe God is that incompetent. And I know God is not incompetent at all. So the prosperity plan, the only ones that have prospered and will prosper is the preacher. Look at Creflo Dollar. The Lord told him, get a plane. The congregation raised $65 million and bought him a plane.
So you don't think God preached to him, that gave him that message?
Go get a job and go to work.
No. Before we go, because we're going to stay on, we got a lot of stuff because I went to. So let me go back to T.D. Jakes, right?
Yeah.
You put something on the screen where he was at P. Diddy's party.
Well, I didn't put that on.
Well, somebody put it on there.
Yeah, somebody put that on there. He was at.
Did you have a problem with that?
Oh, yes.
Tell me why.
Scripture says in Leviticus 10:10, put a difference between holy and unholy, clean and unclean.
Right.
If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature, all things have passed away, behold, all things have become new. If I'm a born again Christian,
right,
it's supposed to be a change in my life.
Right.
Why would you find me in the same place as I used to be when I was a sinner? Why would I be in a strip club looking at a woman come down the pole?
Right.
Why would I be drinking liquor? When the Bible says wine is a strong drink, wine is a mark of strong drink is raging. He that is deceived thereby is not wise.
So you can't drink wine?
Oh no, you having a bit of drinking, getting all drunk, and the Bible says—
I didn't say get drunk, I said a little, holy wine.
The scriptures allow wine in the Lord's Supper. The scriptures allow wine if you have a stomach or infirmity. But just drinking wine for leisure and for pleasure, as he was sitting there with his champagne glass and with his self dancing to the music. Oh, that's—
let me stay here for 1 second, because I've been thinking about this all night, right? So you would have a problem with him doing that at that kind of setting, right? But what if it was his son, daughter's birthday party, a birthday or anniversary, and he was having fun with his family? Would you look at it the same way?
Yes, I will.
For real?
As God's people, I don't believe the scriptures have never give us leverage and have respect to persons. See, there's only one rule of law, and that's God's law. And the law of God don't change for our house. No more does it change if we're outside of our house. See, it's not like it's wrong for me to smoke at somebody else's party, but it's all right to smoke if I do it in the house.
Right.
The scriptures just make a sweeping statement, cleanse yourself from all filthiness of the flesh. Is it all right for me to be gay at home, but not all right to be gay outside? No, it's a sweeping indictment not to be gay at all. So it is not where you are that justify you, is what you do according to the eyes of scripture that justify you. And what problem is this? We have a tendency to water down the scriptures or ignore them and put our feelings and our personal emotions above God's principle. It is God's principle first, and then how we look at things later.
Mm-hmm. I want to stay here for a second, just because a lot of people were asking me questions about this T.D. Jakes stuff.
Yeah.
And I think that you've been on it for a while.
Yes.
Right? Because I guess because you've had some problems, and you can put it in your own words, with his message or the messenger, right? So then the P.D.D. stuff come up, right? And it's almost like I told you so, right?
Exactly.
But people have been talking about it, but there has not, unless you've seen some concrete evidence that he had any kind of homosexuality or anything. I mean, it's been allegations, right?
Yeah.
Allegations, right?
Yeah.
But nobody, to my knowledge, have come out with a tape or anything like that. Am I right?
Well,
we assume.
I always stands like this. The book of scripture says we speak that which we do know and testify to what we see. The only thing I've seen him at Diddy's party, and Diddy taking pictures with Diddy and sign language with Diddy, and Diddy putting his head on his chest and all that stuff. All the other stuff I don't know anything about, what he's doing and how he's doing it. And I hope he's not doing it. But them that have hung out at Diddy's parties have said his parties only consist of two things, sex and money. Me as a God-fearing man, I have no business being in that atmosphere, period. I can't try to use the scripture with Jesus. Like some people have said, well, even Jesus hung out with prostitutes. Jesus didn't hang out with prostitutes at all. The prostitutes came to him and Jesus was teaching them. So he wasn't at the party telling no woman she's loose. He wasn't at the party witnessing to nobody about Jesus. If you're dancing and drinking and hanging out, there have to be a separation of lifestyle. As a preacher, you cannot try to be church and Hollywood. They don't mix. As a preacher, you cannot try to be church and a celebrity. They don't mix. I'm not trying to be a celebrity. I'm not trying to be known. I'm not trying to mingle with Hollywood. I don't care who you are, where you come from. I'm going to bring to you one law. That's God's law. And when I bring to you God's law, you have two alternatives, accept it or reject it.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Community Crossfire, Another Point of View. I'm your host, Stormy Norman Oliver. Got my good friend and entrepreneur, Pastor Gino Jennings. And you could type in, we're on DETV, so you could type in questions and stuff like that. Let me do this a different kind of way, right? Let me ask you a question.
Sure.
How would you deal with, right? Because I hear you talking about Denzel Washington, Tyler Perry, Chris, all these guys, right? if they came to your church?
If they come in, they would come like anybody else. Take a seat, and after service, when I'm done teaching, I get a chance to greet you. Would I give you special privileges? No.
Huh.
You're not better.
Even if they gave you $1 million?
I wouldn't. Number one, if they gave me $1 million, I wouldn't accept it.
Get out of here.
Tyler Perry.
On behalf of the church?
I wouldn't let the church accept it. The scripture says this, he that gathered riches and not by right dies a fool. If you're a drug dealer.
But that's not by right. I mean, the man just, I mean, he's not, I've never known them guys be drug dealers. I mean, they.
Let me make an example.
Okay, make an example, because I got to hear this.
If you're a drug dealer.
Right.
And I know you're a drug dealer. And you come and give me $1 million of drug money. I'm partaking in your evil deed.
I can see that.
And I'm strengthening the hands of an evil doer. So I know that Tyler Perry was a cross-dresser and probably still is. So if he give me $1 million from indulging in cross-dressing and mimicking a woman, whom the scripture says if a man put on a woman's apparel, it's an abomination. And then I accept that money, I'm endorsing what he's doing. So if I'm endorsing what he's doing, I can't preach against what he's doing and then accept money from him.
Well, okay. Time. Let's use Oprah Winfrey and Denzel Washington. They're not cross-dressing. Would you accept theirs?
No.
That's hard to believe. I mean, I believe you because you.
If you don't, if you don't.
I've talked to you a lot of times.
The reason why I wouldn't accept $1 million from Denzel Washington because of his Hollywood blaspheme against God. See, if when you make movies and you're quoting a script, and if there's blasphemy in that script, a good example, when he did the movie of Malcolm X, directed by Spike Lee, there's a scene when he was in jail.
Right.
He was saying, God ain't did nothing for me.
Right.
Well, they would say he's acting. The scripture says, by your words you're justified, and by thine words thou shalt be condemned. When he commented about the movie with the gentleman that played the role of Black Panther. The last movie he did, Black Bottom, about this popular blues singer. It was about 5 or 10 or 15 minutes that they gave him. Right. Nothing but clear blaspheme. He cussed God and MF God and MF Jesus and everything. If these men or women gonna break biblical principle just for money, blaspheme God just for money, play with the Bible just for money, make mockery of scripture truth just for money, and I'm going to take that money, I'm just as much as a hypocrite as they are.
So even if it's acting role, you can't separate?
Oh, no. No, I will not separate scripture from reality. For really, the scripture is going to judge us, and our entire life must evolve around scripture.
Huh. So let me ask you a question, right? It appears to me, because you just come right off the top of your head, so you like a biblical scholar.
I don't look at myself as a biblical scholar.
You know the book
back and forth. I certainly look at myself as a biblical believer.
Okay. But have you always studied the Bible when it comes natural? Because now you can read and understand scriptures like you do?
Well, as time went on, I had to grow. I had to grow and develop in the scriptures, just like you have to grow and develop in anything else in life. And God will open up your understanding to what is written in the scriptures, which causes you to be able to put things in right perspective. And this is where churches have failed. Things have gotten out of perspective. In church, God's supposed to be first. In fact, that's supposed to be the teaching of church. Mm-hmm. God first, everything second. That's not the teaching of church no more. Money is first, and you get to God whenever you get the chance. So they have made money their God, just like Israel have made the calf their God. Mm-hmm. Money becomes the God of the church. Prosperity becomes the God of the church. And entertainment have replaced the sincerity of the church. It was this preacher, I can't think of his name, New Year's Day, I think it was. And he's on social media that was bragging about how he turned his church to a nightclub.
That's all that.
Can you imagine?
Yeah, that's all that. Yeah.
And then said 150 people got saved. Who in their right mind ever went to a nightclub and got saved in a nightclub? So this goes to show you how church is taken less and less serious. And the sinner, he and she have lost respect for the church. They are sinners, I tell you, they'll never step foot in the church again because of what they see. Now, what they seen years ago and what they see now is no comparison because it is worse now than it was years ago.
So as I was telling you, like, people send me a lot of stuff, right? But before I go there, I was gonna ask you a question, right? Because my mind is going erases. If you were to say you were one person in the Bible or like that, who would that person be? I give you good questions, don't I?
I don't.
Would it be like somebody like Paul?
I don't try to liken myself to any specific person in the scriptures. Because the Bible says.
And I'm not saying that, but I'm just saying, who would you think that you were most like? I'm not saying that you are that person.
I believe that I would possess the boldness of the Apostle Paul, but I want the boldness and the humility of Christ himself.
Oh, wow.
You have to be balanced.
That's a good answer.
Bold with humility. Because if you bold without humility, you just careless.
I like that.
See?
So a guy sent me something. I don't even know these people, right?
Yeah.
He said, Norm, look at Pastor Jennings' church, right? And me and you had these questions.
Yes.
The men said over here. He said, do the women have to wear head guard?
In the scriptures, the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians, it says, if a woman pray or prophesy having her head uncovered, she dishonor her head. So when a woman is worshiping God, she have her head covered. And the scripture also says, for this cause ought the woman to have power on her head because of the angels. The angels bear the shape of men. And having her head covered is not a sign of respect, not only towards man on earth, but towards God in heaven.
I like that. So when they walk through your door, do you give them a cover if they
don't
have it?
No, I mean, if people come in, visitors come in all the time.
Yeah, I see that, yeah.
So it is something that the scriptures teach, and we teach it. We don't demand a guest to come in and we're going to wrap your head up. No,
you can't
scale a fish till you catch it. You don't start eating the fish.
This guy.
It's just like the scriptures speak about, don't wear that which pertain to a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment. For all that do so is an abomination. But if a man come in with a dress on, we're not going to scoop him up and escort him out and make him put on pants. Let him come in, get seated, let him hear the word of God, let the word of God convict his heart and let him make the change. Because if you're going to change clothes just because you're coming, but your heart didn't change, all you're going to do is go right back out and put on the same thing you had on.
I saw one of your services where a young white guy came up there, and he was talking like he wanted to hurt people and all that. And you were like, get the demon out of you. Do you remember that one? I mean, this guy was going crazy. He was really feeling it, right? And you were holding him tight, right?
Oh, you're talking about doing a dedication service.
Yeah, yeah.
Was praying for a brother. I think he may have been Hispanic.
Yeah, yeah, right.
And he said he was possessed by the devil.
I remember that. So what goes through your mind as a pastor? Because that could have got out of control. You know what I'm talking about?
Well, I've dealt with possession. It's not this Hollywood version of possession where your head turned back.
Exodus and all that.
You know, spitting out oatmeal.
But this guy.
Possession is for real.
And it's, I saw it, man.
Oh, yeah. Possession is for real. Just like a person can be possessed by God by being good and righteous and holy.
So when you say, let it out of you, let it out of you.
Basically, when I was calling upon the name of the Lord, I was really asking God to really get this devil out of this person. Like in the 5th chapter, I believe in the book of Matthew, where there was a man who was possessed of the devil. And Jesus asked the spirits that was in him, what is thy name? And he said, my name is Legion, for we are many. So a person, and this is what's driving man to be so hateful, so wicked, and so evil, because of his rejection of God. And when you reject God, you become an open door. You become nothing but an open door for Satan to possess mind, soul, body, and spirit.
So you believe people actually have the devil in them?
Oh, yes. Without question. If a person don't believe that the devil is real, look at the chaos that is in the world. What drives a man to just rape a woman for nothing?
Wow.
What drives a man to rape his own mother? What drives a man to sodomize his own son? What drives a man to beat up a woman in the street? She's a woman, for goodness sake. What drives a man to go kill someone just because of the color of their skin? What drives them to do this? What drives politicians to tell lies while they're running for offices? Then once they get in office, they don't live up to nothing what they say. They just talk a good game until they get in office.
Don't you think, right? I'm glad you brought that up, right?
Yeah.
Don't you think because you're such a powerful force, right? I mean, let's be real. We have people who follow us, right? That you be a dynamic in guiding, especially young black men and women, right? In the political world, even though you don't want to be it, you see some things, right? That if you say, I know you said you don't endorse, right?
Right.
This person would be good for or state, city, county, or country. You don't want to do that, but don't you think that you will be, you understand my point? I mean, well, like I look at Reverend Dr. King, right?
I take this under consideration. In Dr. King's day, that generation was totally different.
Exactly.
I mean, totally different. It's just as different from that generation than this, considering he was only 39 years old when he got killed.
Right.
Malcolm was only 39 years old when he got killed. Mecca Evers was only in his 20s when he got killed. Them children was skipping school and marching and end up in jail and went to jail willingly.
Right.
So the generation is totally different. Today, men want power and want money and want fame, want notoriety, but they don't want to live up to whatever promises they made the community. They don't want to live up to whatever things they say they would do to the people. I mean, excuse
me. If you had a person in your church,
yeah,
right, one of these brothers, right,
mm-hmm.
who felt that they were moved to run for a political office, and they came to you, and you knew what kind of ethics they had, right, you still would not help them out?
It isn't that I wouldn't help a brother. If his agenda does not contradict God's agenda at all.
Right.
See, it's not a sin to be a politician. A king is a politician.
Thank you for saying that. I used to be a politician.
See, a king is a politician.
Who's the left?
What you think David was? David was a king.
Right.
What you think Hezekiah was? He was a king.
Right.
Josiah, these were righteous men. The difference in them and these today, they feared God and kept their priorities right. Today, these politicians, they have no fear for God today. They don't respect God today, and they don't seek God for judgment, how to lead the people or how to live up to the promises they made the people. And then they become pressured. They give in to pressure. See, if they put God first and become stable in the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they would not allow themselves to be pressured into lying and false promises, giving false hope, and they know they won't live up to nothing that they're saying. See, if I can't do a thing, if I was running for office, and if I can't do nothing, a particular thing, I'm gonna tell you I can't do it. Or tell you I will try to do it. And before I leave office, if I haven't fulfilled what I said, I'm gonna apologize for making that promise. Why, these men and women don't apologize when hardly not make living up to nothing.
It's funny you say that, right? Because I do have a problem, right?
Mm-hmm.
With the evangelicals, right?
Yeah.
The way they've gotten behind Donald Trump, regardless what he's done.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, like, abortions, women taking them to court, you know, rape and all that. And they seem to turn the other cheek, but they say, I'm holier than thou. I do have a problem with that. And I mean, as a matter of fact, the Catholic Church just endorsed it in
Trump,
New Hampshire.
Trump give them, you know, you give somebody a few crumbs and they become so blind, they think they have a loaf of bread.
Mm-hmm.
Trump says he does not endorse homosexuality. He does not endorse abortion and things of that order. So because he don't endorse those few little things, the evangelical group endorse him. Well, if you're going to endorse him, two wrongs, as old people used to say, don't make it right.
Yeah.
He endorsed adultery. He endorsed living together, not married.
So how can these pastors support and endorse him?
Easy, it's called hypocrisy. You can't get sweet and bitter water from the same fountain. And this is what I mean. I will not endorse someone if one thing they believe that contradicts that book. For me, it has to be all God's way or no way. Otherwise than that, I become a partaker of the evil deed. And I refuse to do that.
Is there one scripture in the book that you follow? Or, I mean, I know you follow a lot, but if you say, Norm, read this scripture and you'll get it.
Acts 2:38.
Okay.
When it says, repent and be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. If one have a repentant heart, mm-hmm. they go before God day and night, asking God to forgive them for whatever sins they committed. And they were really submit themselves to God's rule of law and be baptized in water in the name of the Lord Jesus and take the time and really seek God for the Holy Spirit and then learn the ways of God, which will sharpen the characteristics of man. Man who tried to live outside of God's way, he'll be like a mad animal. He'll be mean and evil, hateful, despiteful, and he'll fight everything you bring to him that is righteous. But if a man humble himself, the scripture says, if my people which are called by my name will humble themselves and seek my face, and then will I hear from heaven. So when man is trying to live his life fighting God,
right,
rejecting God, and he'll talk about God on occasion, but really give his life to him. I often tell brothers and sisters, you're getting older. You didn't discover no magic water to get young. You're getting older. And it comes a time in your life where one really have to take serving God very sincerely.
I like that.
Because all of us is going to stand before God. We either will be accepted by him or rejected by him. I'd rather be rejected by people than rejected by God.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Community Crossfire, Another Point of View. I'm your host, Norman Oliver, with Pastor Jennings. This is a good interview. It's kind of different than the last two we had. I hope you're enjoying the questioning. So last time we talked, right, I told you I went to Israel.
Yeah.
Stayed in Tel Aviv and went to Bethlehem and Jerusalem and all that kind of good stuff. What do you think of what's happening over there now?
With the war.
Gaza and all that.
And the Gaza Strip. When Hamas first attacked Israel, the scripture says, Sarah, which is Abraham's wife, is Jerusalem. Then the scripture says, Hagar, which was Abraham's handmaiden, is Arabia. So the Jews and the Arabs had the same father, which is Abraham, but just simply have a different mother. One come from Hagar, which is the bond one. One come from Sarah, which the scriptures call the free woman. They start out fighting Hamas, but then it went out of control. For now, they declared war pretty much against every Palestinian, period. Now, if you declaring war against every Palestinian, women, children, babies, and everything, now you step into a whole different realm of genocide. So I'm really interested in seeing, will Israel be charged with war crime? Because they charge Germany, they charge other countries, and Israel should not be exempted. If someone say, free Palestine, okay, let's do that.
But why do you think they have not?
The reason why they...
Because they're Jewish?
Because Jews have a strong stranglehold on America and the world.
See what they did to Kanye West?
Practically every industry of business, the Jews are in charge. So it kind of placed a fear of anybody speaking out. School teachers today, my daughter's a school teacher.
Okay.
And she just said, she had a quote, free Palestine. And just from that quote, the school district got on her and she called me about it. And I told her, stand up to them. Because you're not saying free Hamas, you're saying free the Palestinian people, which is just as different as day and night. So Israel have really took the war. A hospital had nothing to do with Hamas. A shelter had nothing to do with Hamas. To kill innocent babies, Jewish graves, you're gonna take a bulldozer and just dig up the bodies of Jews who just been killed and murdered and just leave their bodies strolled all around the ground. What have you accomplished? What have you gained? So this had really went so far until Biden is scared of Netanyahu. He won't say anything. So this is really escalating. Other countries are getting involved and to fulfill the scriptures, there shall be wars and rumors of wars. But Israel, yes, need to be indicted for genocide and for downright murder.
So some of your fellow pastors, right, who rally against you are,
yes,
just do not like the way you come at them.
Yes.
Have they ever, who's this guy? This guy, Pete Rambo or somebody. I mean, all these people, they send me emails like I know them. So, like, do you just ignore it?
Because of our popularity on social media, I find out that a lot of these fellas call my name for ratings, to get ratings.
I got you.
Subscribers, or just draw attention to their webcast. A lot of these guys, I hardly even know they exist. So I just let them talk. And I often tell viewers, don't log on to the websites to go back and forth with these different men.
Right.
Let them feel free to say what they want, because I'm not going to log on and just waste my time and argue with you.
What I do notice about you,
yeah,
every time you debate, right, even the guy in Jamaica who you had escorted out, was he in Jamaica?
Yeah.
You just say, stick to the Bible.
That's it.
So it doesn't even matter all that other stuff.
All that other stuff doesn't matter. It is written, whatsoever things are written aforetime is written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. So my hope is in the scriptures. So you can give me a long litany of talk and talk and talk. And when you're done, I'm done hearing you out, I'm going to tell you, come on back to the Bible and show me that in the book. Like the years of quotation, there are three separate and distinct persons in the Godhead. Jesus is the second person of the Godhead. The Holy Ghost is the third person of the Godhead. I tell the Trinity believers, just read me that scripture that says Jesus is the second person of the Godhead. The Holy Ghost is the third person of the Godhead. Just show me that scripture that says that. And I can't get a customer because they know it never was in there. So a lot of teachings that a lot of churches have are actually European teaching, because that teaching came from the European church. It came from the Catholic Church. Jesus is the second person in the Godhead. The Holy Ghost is the third person in the Godhead. There's three persons in the Godhead. So the Catholics coined the phrase Trinity. No such statement have ever been in the Bible.
Never.
It never been in there. In Matthew 28:19, when Jesus said, baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, they say, that's the Trinity. I tell them, just use common sense. I'm a son at birth. I'm a husband at marriage. I'm a father because we got children. It is in three distinct persons of me. I'm one person. Who is the father, who is the son, who is the husband? The very first commandment is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. He's creator, he's maker, he's Jehovah, he's the mighty God, he's a healer. Many operations by one God himself.
I just saw where Joe Osteen, I knew Wayne was going to ask this question, remember, just paid his church off for $100 million. Mm-hmm. What's your thoughts on that?
Well, if he got the money, he can pay it off. But if you preach what Joe Osteen preached, which is absolutely nothing, it would be very easy to pay his church off.
If he had, how can you say the man stopped preaching absolutely nothing? He got like 20,000 people in his church, right? So he got to be saying something.
He's a motivational speaker. That doesn't make him a preacher.
Huh.
Motivational speakers, you can go to school to learn that. To be a preacher, that's God-given. Because preaching is a gift. The book says every good gift, every perfect gift come from above, come down from the Father of lights, of whom there is no variables, no shadow of turning. If you got a real God-made preacher, he'll speak out against sin. He'll speak out against all sin. He'll speak out against evil. He'll speak out against wickedness, and he'll stand up for truth. Name one evil thing that Joel Osteen speak out against. He said everybody going to be in heaven. The homosexuals, everything. He said, ain't nobody gonna be in hell. The man had Conway West performing for him. It's just entertainment. This is the road where religion has gone down to, entertainment. It's party, it's fun, it's joking, it's jesting. It's not about the sincerity of God whatsoever. And what's so scary is none of these men is even thinking of the day of judgment that's gonna come upon everybody. Imagine standing before God and he call you in question for all this racketeering and religious fun that's being done. Wow, and then he punish you for it, eternity.
So what do you say to pastors who go to theology school, whatever, and come out and be called, you gotta call them doctor?
Doctor of divinity. The book of scripture says, let no man therefore deceive you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the rudiments of the world and not after Christ. Theology, theory. God is not a God of theology. He is a God of facts. Because you have a theory about something, that don't mean you are factual in your statement. God is a God of facts, not theory.
Wow, that's deep. Tell me a little bit about your church. I know you moved into a new...
Well, basically, the lower auditorium, we've been now at the church there on Lindley Avenue for a little bit over 5 years.
What's the address of people?
5105 North 5th Street,
okay,
Philadelphia, right in the corner of 5th and Lindley Streets. We've been in the lower auditorium that seats about 1,200. So we've been holding services there where we've been broadcasting from. So we finally finished the main auditorium.
It's beautiful, by the way.
Well, thank you very much. And we just dedicated it last month. And
that's when they had the dedication. When
yeah, it's we can hold 3,000 in the main auditorium, but that's too small to hold all the congregation because we had to use the lower auditorium for overflow, the gymnasium for overflow. So this is why our general conventions now is being held at convention centers where we can hold 5,000 or 6,000 or 7,000 people because the main church just won't hold the people.
Man, that's beautiful. So a guy sent me a video, right? People, okay, they sent me all this. So you had the men getting the Holy Ghost over here and the women wasn't. Is that true?
I don't know nothing about that.
Yeah, yeah.
The Holy Ghost is a gift.
So if a woman get the Holy Ghost in your church, they get the Holy Ghost.
The Holy Ghost is for everyone that believe. Anyone that believe, whether they there, whether they anywhere else, it is written, these signs will follow them that believe.
I thought the guy kind of, you know how you could play with videos or something like
yeah.
that? And I was like, that didn't make sense to me.
No, the Holy
Ghost. It really showed all women sitting like this, and the guy's getting the Holy Ghost.
Well,
he was saying, why aren't the, he said, Pastor Jenny's got so much control over these women. This was true. I'll send it to you.
Oh, I'm not surprised at what they would say about me. I don't have no control over the Holy Ghost because the Holy Ghost, which is the Holy Spirit, that's God. The Bible said God is the Spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So the day that I can control God, man, I'm good.
Wow.
But I don't have no power, nor any other man have the power to control the Almighty God of heaven and earth.
I like that. See, I asked a question. Do you guys, anybody have any questions out here?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead. You got a mic right there.
How you doing, Pastor Jennings?
Fine, sir.
I just want to say that I watch your church service every Sunday. I get a lot of enlightenment out of it. There's some things that I did want to ask you, though.
And yes,
it's kind of like I saved this until I saw you because one of the reasons why I got the Apocrypha is because you talked about it and just getting some more understanding of how that correlates with the Bible because a lot of the books are mentioned throughout the Bible.
First and foremost, the word Apocrypha came about from the Catholic Church. Apocrypha means that which is hidden. The Catholic Church, now you can go until into the Jewish synagogues and get one of the old Bibles from the Jewish synagogue. All those books are in there. They've been in the Bible. In fact, in some of your churches, on their pulpit, they may have old fat Bibles, real thick, the old leather. Those books are in most of them. So it isn't that those books are not used. It's just man have took it upon himself to just simply not use them. To say, well, oh, the Bible don't speak of these. Well, in the book of Samuel, it actually make a reference to the book of Jasher. It mentions that. If that's a person's excuse for not using the book, then one can bring the argument and say the Old Testament don't say nothing of, don't say about the book of James, don't say about the book of Jude, don't say about the book of Philemon. But we know this is written. All scriptures are given by the inspiration of God. And it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, instruction, and righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good work. So we believe in having all the scriptures and then allow God time patiently to open up one's understanding to the scriptures. So we search the scriptures to see are these things true. And by searching the scriptures, we take our time and evaluate. And if you really are led by the Spirit, you can go to what people label as the Apocrypha and be able to get the scriptures there and be able to find how those same scriptures correlate with the 66 books that we have. Because the Catholics was the one that says we only have 66 books. No, we do not, because the Bible mentioned more than that. So the churches really are following the pattern that been laid again by the Catholic Church. And what I'm laboring to do with God's help is to pull the churches, pull the people away from the Catholic influence and just look at God influence only.
Wow. Next question.
I have a two-part question, Pastor. I too myself watch you every Sunday and been watching you probably for 10 or 15 years every Sunday. And the first part of my question is, what do you think about the NIV, the Bible, the NIV? And my second part of my question is, why are we living in a society today that does not fear God?
Very good question. The NIV Bible, different brands, if I use that term, of scriptures. The problem that we run into with some of them is they try to reword scripture. And when they try to reword scripture, they actually move the truth content of that scripture out. So this is why I make it my business strongly to just stick with the original text of the scripture. If not, rewording can actually make me believe something that God have never intended for me to believe. On your second question, why did society not fear God? Wow. The scripture says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and to depart from evil is understanding. So if men and women have gotten to the point where they don't fear God, it shows you they're not wise. This generation is presented with so much as a distraction. The young people, they don't want to hear their parents. Many of them won't, they are backtalk their parents. Many of the parents are out there smoking and drinking, trying to be young people themselves when they become of age. Our young women, mothers, are becoming younger and younger, and they are becoming younger and younger grandmothers. No examples today in the pulpits of the churches. The churches are hanging out right out there with the sinner, and yet they say they're a new creature. So when the fear of God began to diminish, the love for sin increased. And this is what Satan want. This is what Satan have orchestrated. This is what Satan have made very appealing to religion until they are catering to that. So therefore, someone like me stick out like a sore thumb because I'm barking scripture and telling people that come on back to scripture and let's get the fear of the Lord. A good example, if you hear, I came from a family of eight, a very close-knit family, a very comical family, family very good with their hands and everything, but we respect mom and pop. Pop was pop, man. He worked three jobs and he was down to earth, but we also knew when he didn't play.
That's right.
He didn't believe in my mother working and none of that. I mean, he was old school. He didn't believe in hitting the woman, none of that. And if we as a family lose fear, respect for our mother and father, imagine the chaos that the house would have been in. It's the same way with church. The church have lost respect, fear for God. So the chaos that is in religion has no choice but to increase. When the fear of God come back among the people, many of the things that's going on in the churches will stop. But where there's no fear for God, there's an increase of money.
Let me follow up on what you're saying, what you're saying right here about family.
Yeah.
But one time I heard you challenged your dad.
Oh, I never challenged my dad.
I mean, on the Bible, I thought.
Oh, yeah. When it came to the Bible, my father...
I do my homework.
My father taught something. Which he made a blatant mistake in that Bible. It wasn't in there. So when he taught it, after service was over years ago, I said, Pop, where's that in the Bible? When the scripture says there was about 120 in the upper room, He said, so therefore there had to be 119. I said, Pop, somebody can come along and say there's 121, 122. It says about 120, so the scriptures didn't nail it down to what number it was. He said, Gene, what you say? I said, I'm going to say what the Bible says about 120, because the book says don't add and don't take away. So I said, being that you taught it was 119, you come on back and correct that open, because you taught it open and to the people. He laughed and put his hand on my shoulder. He said, I got newfound respect for you, son. He said, because if you will not let me, your father, get by, I ain't got to worry about nobody else. And he's right. When it comes to the book,
it don't matter.
It doesn't matter.
So you didn't know I knew that, did you? Another question? Are we good? Go ahead, Tom.
Oh, we good.
This is good.
Yeah, thanks for having me, brother.
Man, you know, I always enjoy having this guy. I mean, and you know, it's funny, because sometimes you and I laugh and have so much fun, right? And I guess one of the people from the church, they said, Norman Oliver, are you drunk? Because I'm like, well, why can't we both laugh?
I think because people just see me in church on a telecast in the pulpit. Right. So therefore, they judge me one way.
Yeah, boom.
But me as a person, they really don't know.
Oh, you cool.
I'm a very down-to-earth person. Most men that have this many thousands followers that we in the church that we are blessed with or have churches all over the world like we do, they are very arrogant, very high-minded, and they feel as though they're above you. I wasn't raised like that. I'm a very down-to-earth person.
I always wonder, right, some of these churches, like those mega churches, how do you even get to them? You don't even get a chance to ever talk to them in life.
Most time they don't. Most time the preachers feel as though he is too important, too high to talk to the people.
Can't even talk to the people.
Reverend, he should realize that his success, God will deal with people to aid him in his success. He won't get there on his own.
Before time, I'm going to ask you one more quick question, right?
Yeah.
Because last time we talked, I said something about Reverend Sharpton.
Mm-hmm.
You said he's, whatever, I forget. You said he wasn't a reverend. He's a...
Opportunist. Yeah.
How did you feel like Dr. Ralph Afernacle, I'm sorry. Huh? Afernacle. And King and Jesse Jackson, those guys. And I thought that they were kind of activists too. Or did you put them in different categories?
I would put them in a different category. Dr. King, from a religious perspective and biblical perspective, I would not agree with, if I use the term, his biblical theology, as far as being baptized and having the Holy Spirit, the way it's supposed to be taught and things from that nature. But his stance against racism, I would agree with him 100%. His methodology of resolving race issues were different. I believe Mahatma Gandhi was the one he emulated.
Right.
And Gandhi was very effective in his day. Martin Luther King methods was very effective in his day.
So your methods are very good in your day.
Yes. The thing that challenged him, though, was Malcolm. Malcolm's method was more rigid than Dr. King. And I believe society would have been, it would be like a tsunami if Martin Luther King and Malcolm would have merged. It would have been such, because you had...
But that's a good question. Who do you think you're more like?
I think Malcolm gave you a more rigid,
right,
confrontational alternative. Malcolm was like this. If Martin don't work...
Come over here.
You can try it my way. Malcolm was more or less...
Do you think you like both?
An eye for an eye. Well, I can accept both depending on what we're dealing with. I understand Malcolm's frustration and what he want to resort to, and I understand Martin's frustration and the wisdom he used with the methods that he had. So from both perspectives, I do understand.
Like that.
Fine, sir.
I listen to you sometimes too as well. A question. What I find, because I'm a religious guy, I go to church too, but what I've been finding, like, what is it or why is that ministers today, a lot of them have like different conflicts with one another. Some of them don't want to, really communicate or have something between one another, because is it the way they teach their church? Or I mean, I find a lot of conflict with different ministers.
Man. That's a good question.
One of the conflicts that bring up among ministers, in a lot of cases, ego, competition, and one of the biggest things, racism. There's a lot of prejudice among preachers of various different color groups. And one of the biggest things is doctrine, belief, wherein some men are just preaching what is called a hand-me-down message. In other words, what I'm teaching, I got from Bishop so-and-so. And what that bishop got, he got from his bishop. And what that bishop got, he got from his bishop. And nobody ever, never took the time out to ask Bishop, is these things so? Is these things for real? And this is why when I broadcast over the air, I encourage church people, question your preacher. Question them. And a lot of preachers take offense to that. They say, just do what I say, not what I do. No, if you're going to patronize these preachers financially and you're going to constantly go to their churches, then you have a right to question them about what they're teaching, just like when you go to school. When you go to school, you question your math teacher, English teacher, history teacher. But in churches, they are taught not to do this. I'm the man of God. You take what I say. Man, look, you're a man born of a woman just like I am. And I've got just that much right to question you about what you teach, where did you get it from, and see is it biblically legit or either you got it from some school.
Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed this segment. God, this is our third one. We got to do a fourth one. I ask you all the questions and
yes,
you
sir.
Answer them.
Yes,
this was one of the, I like this one.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a different flow.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed, my good friend. Thank you for coming, my friend.
Always a pleasure.
Always
man.
A pleasure. And he's going to, so what we've been doing, we've been having black men rallies.
Yeah.
Just speaking about issues. Like me and you were talking last mm-hmm. time about what's happening in our streets, violence. You know, we're talking about Black Lives Matter. He's like, nah. And I would love for you to come down and be one of my keynote speakers.
Let us know when the dates
let
are.
Let us know.
And if I'm able to come, I definitely would be there, God willing.
God willing. I like that, man. Keep me in prayer, man.
Thank you, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's it. This is Community Crossfire. I'm Ivan. Where you at, Ive? Thank you, Big Ive. You want to say hi to people? I don't know. You're a big time guy. You know, he got us in this little, like, it looks nice, right?
The studio looked very well.
You did your thing, man. Thank you all. I'm out of here like Vladimir.
Yes, sir.
You good, man.
Payback. Payback.